Good evening, W3CU. Why don't you guys go ahead and stand to your feet and we will start with worship. I know you guys can clap, so let's try it out. Ready? Yeah. Guys, just keep that going.
Our God and firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. In all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in the name of Jesus. Oh, we trust the name of Jesus. Victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Oh, oh, oh.
Amen, amen. How many of y'all think God is good? Amen. He's good all the time, isn't he? Won't you guys just take a seat for a moment? I just want to welcome you tonight. I am so thrilled that you've chosen to be with us. This is the last night of revival, if you didn't know. But, you know, we pray that it's not an end, that it's a beginning to the next chapter. Amen? Hey, I just wanted to mention a couple things. Number one is, if you W3CU, we had a busy week, right? But you know what tomorrow is? Tomorrow we have the awesome privilege of serving our friends and neighbors through our food and clothing pantry, right? And so if you can come and help tomorrow, you'll be blessed. Man, I'm going to tell you, we have the best time doing that. And we start usually we start setting up about 3:30, 3:45. Now we distribute food between 4:30 and 6:30. So if you're in the area, if you want to come, you can say, well, I've got a half hour. Come help for a half hour. Just you'll be blessed for helping for a half hour. But we would love to have you come and be part of that ministry. You just wouldn't believe what a blessing it is. The folks that we serve are so thankful that you guys do this for them. They are so thankful for that. And, man, there's just nothing like seeing those smiling faces, getting to talk to those precious people, and just spend time with them. And I always try to go around and pray with everybody that I can and talk to them about Jesus, and it's just a great opportunity. So if you want to come tomorrow, I'd love to have you. And then the other thing I want to mention to you is our Easter invites. And I think Ricky might mention these maybe a little bit tonight, right? But grab one of these, okay? There's two different ones. They say basically the same thing. On the back, there's a QR code that can get detailed information about Easter and plan a visit here to our church. But here's what you do. Pray about it. Pray about who to give it to. Pray over the card. Hand it to somebody and say, hey, I'd love for you to come and sit with me on Easter. What service are you coming to? And they say, well, I'm coming to 11. And you're like, well, I was thinking I was going to go at 9. You say, well, you know what? I'm coming to 11 too, right? And you come to both services and you just sit with them during one of them. Amen? Amen. All right. That's awesome. So you guys are getting this. So I'm going to tell you, I know that all 600 of these are going to be gone by Sunday, right? Amen? Yep. All right, so you make sure you pick them up and go and invite people to come be with us. We are so thrilled that you're here tonight. Would you stand to your feet? We're going to go back into a time of worship, but I just want to pray as we do. Jesus, we worship you tonight, God, in all that we do, in everything we say, let your name be glorified and lifted up. God, you are worthy of all of our praise, Lord. You're worthy of every bit, every ounce of adoration, devotion, and energy and passion we can give to you, Lord. And I am praying this evening, God, that you'd open our hearts as we worship, Lord, that you would manifest your presence in this place, Lord, that we would leave here changed because of the word you've given to Ricky to share with us tonight and because of this time spent in your presence. Holy Spirit, come, we invite you and give you free reign here. Come and wreck our plans, Lord. Come and change our lives. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Give him a clap of praise, church.
Above all names, Jesus.
Our God is risen, you're alive and breathing. There's nothing that can rise against your victory. Your name is higher still. Oh, your name is higher still. Oh, praise, oh, praise to the name above all names, Jesus, you reign, 'cause you're the name above all names. You're worthy of all our praises, and the cross still stands, the blood still flows, the work is finished, and hell still knows that the grave is still empty, the stone is still rolled, and you're still high and lifted up, you're still seated on the throne, the cross still stands, the blood still flows, the work is finished, and hell still knows the grave is still empty, the stone is still rolled, you're still high and lifted up, you're still seated on the throne. Oh, praise, oh, praise to the name above all names, Jesus, you reign, 'cause you're the name above all names. Hallelujah. Every voice will proclaim, there is no higher name. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're a living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, and your presence will Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
There's nothing worth more.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're a living hope. Your presence, Lord. I'll taste it and see the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, in your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become You see me in the valley low. There is no home without you here. I find you in the crowded thoughts. You quiet all the question marks. There is no space your love won't fill. I'll trade all my fear for peace of mind. All my heaviness for burdens light. And this will be my song. You are always good.
Goodness that you are. Just let your spirit be in this place. Let us be sensitive because we know it's already here. are these things in your wonderful, amazing name. Amen.
I wanted to go and pick this table up just so that she wouldn't make me look bad carrying this thing out. And so I said, Lord, I'm not going to let her show me up. I'm going to go pick that thing up today myself. I am so excited about tonight, and I am so excited about you being here. And you know, I believe that God's got the people that he really desired to be here tonight. Amen. And I'm just excited about just what I'm going to be teaching tonight. Unfortunately, you know, I really get sad. Do you realize I've been coming here for 23 years? Amen. Amen. That's a long time. And, you know, I have relationships now. And I have people that I've known for that time and even longer. And so I just almost hate to go home. But my wife called me and said, you better hurry up and get home, so I'm going home. Amen, amen, amen. And so you know, I told you last night that I'm just not here for motivation, and especially tonight I'm not here for motivation because motivation just doesn't last long. And then I'm not here for, really, inspiration. That doesn't last long either. But I'm here for identification, and especially tonight. Because when we start talking about something like revival, revival is not just something we have for a week and then we go back to work as business as usual. That's just not what revival is. Revival is God stirring something up in our hearts that will empower us to go out and fall in love with him deeper and deeper and deeper. And as we fall in love with God deeper and deeper and deeper, we have a deep desire to impact people like never before. And it never goes just one way. Oh, God, I want more of you. No, it is God, as you pour you into me, I'm going to go out and impact people like never before. Isn't that the truth? Amen. Come on, you can talk to me tonight. It's okay. And so tonight, you know, I'm going to be coming from this wonderful passage that I appreciate and love and respect. And this passage, I mean, really, really a good passage. And the reason why I wanted to preach on this tonight is that, like, even my mentality sometimes can be unhealthy. Because, you know, a lot of times what happens with us is we come in and we like things comfortable, don't we? No, we really do. You know, I started here 23 years ago, and I've gotten older. And as I get older, you know, I kind of want to lean into being comfortable. That's what we do. And because really, we really have a reason to be comfortable. Many of us have raised up a whole lot of children. We've worked hard for 30 or 40 years. We've done so many things in our lives. And now we get to this wonderful age, and we say, man, I want a break. So then what we do is we go into retirement. And just to show off our comfort, our desire for comfort, we say, man, I'm going to just go out and play golf. You know what I mean? I'm just going to go out and have fun, or I'm going to go take some sewing classes or computer classes. And we desire this comfort. And for me, that's a very good thing, to desire comfort. But just even one day, as I was reading this passage, I said, Lord, I'm not going to be like most guys. I'm not just going to go out and wait for the next elk or deer to show up in my nice, comfortable life, and then all of a sudden I've got me a big freezer full of deer meat. Amen, amen. I'm trying to get in your coach, if you didn't notice. I've never shot a deer before in my life. I was talking to a guy the other day, and he was talking to me about killing deer, and I said, what? I said, what you killing with? And he said, man, I got a safe full of shotguns. I said, what in the world? I won't be spending the night with you, brother. But anyway, now I'm... But, you know, I do respect cultures. Amen, amen. And I do like deer meat. So, but anyway, I told you, Pastor, I'll go off track in a minute. But you see, we all like comfort. And so tonight I thought I would name this message from, now listen, it's from comfort to chaos. Isn't that something? Because this is what this is the agreement I made with the Lord. I said, God, I'm not going to go and leave this world just simply relaxing. And I'm not going to leave it. I'm not going to leave this world, you know, from a seated position in some recliner where I've just really taken a nice little rest and I've gotten where I was comfortable. God, I want to stay in the game. And I want to take the game to the next level. And you know what? When I get before the Father, I want to be able to tell the Father, Father, I left it all on the field. That, Father, I am exhausted and you have worn me out. But I did it for you, Father. And I want to just simply challenge you. What about you? What are you really doing with your life? That's right. I don't care what your age is. It doesn't matter. What are you doing with your life? Are you going to settle for living this wonderful life of comfort? Or are you going to get back in the game? And when I say get back into the game, there's some of you, you don't even serve very much anymore. And even when you serve comfortably. And what God is saying, get back in the game. You may have stepped out of the game and you don't even give anymore. And God is saying, listen, you've paid your house off. You've got more resources at your disposal now than you've ever had. You should be blessing everybody you see. Get back in the game. And so I want to talk to you about a few people who had gotten out of the game, who really did, you know what I mean? They had totally gotten out of the game. And God said, get back in the game. It's time to play. The stakes are too high. Impact the world like never before. And so what I want to do is I want to read one of the great commissions. Now notice I said one of the great commissions. Because you all are familiar with Matthew chapter 28, right? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that you remember that, don't you? Obey all that I've commanded you, and lo, I'll be with you always, and even until the very end of the age. That's Matthew's version. But Luke's got a version of the great commandment, and John certainly has a version. And then Luke comes back in Acts and gives another version of the great commandment. Isn't that good? Well, I want to read that one because I think it's so important. And it's Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Now, what's so amazing about this that I'm going to read in Luke is this. When I read this one, I'm going to turn around and I'm going to read Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. And it's almost as if Jesus repeats the same commandment. And therefore, the question that I've been asking is, why in the world did Jesus repeat? Why did Luke have to repeat this same commandment? And we're going to investigate the why. Is that okay? Oh, amen. Come on, somebody. Help me out in here tonight. Now, listen to here. So in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, listen to what it says. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere. In Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Isn't that good? No, look at it. I mean, you should look at it. It says, you will be my witness. Now listen here. Listen, geography now. He jumps in it, telling people everywhere. And so he starts, now in the center you see Jerusalem. He said, but you're not just going to do it in Jerusalem. Look, the next circle is Judea. Can you see that? Yeah, it's the white area, right? The green is the center. That's Jerusalem. Judea is the second. Then he said, you're going to go to Samaria. But once you leave Samaria, you're going to go to the ends of the earth. See, he's talking geography. Now, I'm going to tell you in just a minute why geography is so important, but let me read the second passage in Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. Listen to this now, and you're going to hear some of the same terminology. He says in chapter 8, verse 1, he says, Saul was one of the witnesses, and he agreed completely with the killing of Stephen. Oh, my God. A great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church. Now, here it comes. Persecution sweeping over the church in Jerusalem, and all the believers except the apostles, were scattered through the regions of Judea and Samaria. You see the geography? See, the apostles stayed in Jerusalem, but it says that this persecution that took place, it drove believers throughout Judea and Samaria. And then verse 2 says, some devout men came and buried Stephen with great mourning, but Saul was going everywhere to destroy the church. He went from house to house, dragging out both men and women to throw them into prison. Now here it comes, verse 4, it jumps right back into the motif, Acts chapter 1. It says, but the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus everywhere they went. Ah, isn't that good? Isn't that good? And so the question that I'm asking you, why is it that Luke, one of the greatest writers, intelligent, a doctor, why did he start out in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and then have to come, and 1:8, and then have to come to 8, and then say the same thing? I mean, why in the world did he have to repeat himself? Yes. Let me tell you why. Think about geography, and think about the book of Acts. Here it goes. I'm off as the walk here. I want you to see it. See, in Luke, in Acts chapter 1, remember, Jesus, he had gone back up. But where did he ascend from? He ascended from Jerusalem. But then in Acts chapter 2, you remember the Holy Spirit fell, and then all of a sudden Peter preached a fiery sermon. The church was started, but they were right there in the temple courts. They were still in Jerusalem in chapter 2. Then in chapters 3, you see that Peter and John was walking through the temple courts. Where were they? They were in Jerusalem. And you remember the crippled man walked up and he asked him for a donation. And Peter says, silver and gold have I not, but in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. Guess what? In chapters 3, they were still in Jerusalem. Then in chapters 4, you remember chapter 4 when John, he went before the council. Where was the council? The council was in Jerusalem. But then in Acts chapter 5, you go over and you see Ananias and Sapphira. They lied to the Holy Spirit, and all of a sudden one of them fall out and die. Where were they? They were still in Jerusalem. But then in chapter 6, they have to go in, and they pull an elder board together, and they said, we need some other people to serve the poor. And so they bring on Stephen and Philip. And Stephen and Philip, they start serving the poor. Where are they serving them? In Jerusalem. And then in chapter 7, guess what happens? Stephen goes up, and all of a sudden the council began to accuse Stephen. And Stephen stands up and he tells them about how good God has been to him and who Jesus was. And suddenly that's when they said that Paul signed up, because they killed Stephen. They stoned him to death. But where were they? They were in Jerusalem. 8 chapters passed. 8 chapters. Passed, and they were still in Jerusalem. And thus Luke writes, and he tells us, he said, I got to tell you what, you still hadn't gone anywhere, and so God's got to get you out of Jerusalem. He's got to get you out of this space, because God didn't say go to Jerusalem and sit. He didn't say make Jerusalem great again. He said you got to go somewhere. I want the whole world to know about this. And so all of a sudden, Stephen gets killed, and persecution starts in the church. And guess what happens in chapter 8? All the believers scattered. And you know where they went? Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. And they went all throughout the world, only by persecution. What am I saying? I'm saying this. Why did they stay in Jerusalem? You know why they stayed in Jerusalem? They were comfortable in Jerusalem. Listen, you gotta hear this. Their family was in Jerusalem. Their friends were in Jerusalem. Their neighbors were in Jerusalem. Guess when they spoke the language, they all spoke Hebrew in Jerusalem. They were nice and they were comfortable and they were safe and they were secure in Jerusalem. They knew the people at the grocery store. They knew the people at the barber shop, and they knew everywhere they went, they would be familiar with somebody because Jerusalem was comfortable. The synagogue that they worshiped in, well, guess where it was? It was in Jerusalem. Everything was right there in Jerusalem. And so therefore they decided to stay where it was comfortable. Have you ever been in a place and it's just it gets comfortable? Have you ever been in a city and it gets comfortable? Oh, no. Oh, man, listen, I got my family here. You know, they live about 2 miles from me. If I need to get to them, they're right here near me. So I'm not going anywhere else. Oh, but not only do my neighbors, they live close to me, and I'm not going anywhere else. Oh, no, all my friends, they're here. You know, my church is right here, and right here in the same area, and so I'm going to go to church, and guess what? I've got a small group, and all my small group friends, they all live right here in this one little area, and we're going to just stay here together, and we're going to be real good and comfortable. Oh, and I know the person at the grocery store. Every time I see him, we talk together. And the beauty shop and the barber shop, I know them all. And it's right here in this wonderful, comfortable area. And what God is saying, it is time for you to leave this space that is comfortable and get out in the world and impact the world. Ah. You see, they couldn't go because it was comfortable. And let me tell you, when you get outside of Jerusalem, it was very uncomfortable. Oh, no. You know about the Samaritans. I got to read this one verse to you. You're going to love this one verse. Listen to this one verse. And it's talking about the Samaritans and the relationship with the Jews. And so Jesus was getting ready to go. And listen to this verse. It's in Luke 9, chapter 9, verse 52. Listen to what it says. You got to hear this. It says, one day he sent messengers ahead to reserve rooms for them in a Samaritan village. This is Jesus and the disciples. He sent the disciples ahead and said, hey, we want you to go and we want you to reserve rooms. Go to the hotel and make sure we got a place to stay. But they were turned away. The Samaritans didn't like him. They come to the hotel and said, we don't want you living here. The people of the village refused to have anything to do with them because they were headed toward Jerusalem. They didn't like them. Now listen, you think that's bad. Listen to this. When word came back of what had happened, James and John, they both wrote books in the Bible. These are godly men. These are holy men. Men who love Jesus. Listen, it says James and John said to Jesus, Master, shall we order fire down from heaven to burn them up? That's like a hunter coming and saying, give me my shotgun. In fact, give me my M16. I need something bigger. They wanted to burn the Samaritans up. And the text says Jesus rebuked them. You can't treat people like that. How dare you? Jesus rebuked them. And last night I talked about Peter and the Gentiles. You had all this tension. See, it was safe in Jerusalem, but when you went to Judea, it got a little bit more unsafe. But by the time you get to Samaria, it was dangerous. And so what they said in the early church was, we're going to stay where it's safe. And that's got to be your question here. You know what? You can keep doing church the same way you're doing it for the next 10 years. And you can be safe. And it will never honor the Lord. Because God never calls us to be safe and to be comfortable. God is saying, I need you. Listen, this is why he sent me here. I have called you to leave this comfort, and I need you to get into this chaos that's out here. There are people dying, there are people going to hell, and you up in this safe place with your safe small group, and your children are going to a safe little youth ministry, and no, it's too comfortable in there. Get out of there and get into the world and make an impact. Well, let me help and get out of here. I told you, this is my last night. And my wife said, baby, come on home, so I better go on and give you some principles. Is that all right? So let me give you a couple. I'm going to give you a few principles, and I'm going to go home. Amen. I might take my time tonight. I feel too good. Listen to me. So this is what I call this here. So if I had to name my principles, I would say these are principles that will empower us to shift from comfort into chaos. Now I just want to tell you, because shifting from comfort and you being comfortable sometimes is hard. And so that's why I want to give you principles and tell you what you can expect to happen. Listen to what it says. So the first one is transitioning beyond our comfort zones means if you desire to grow, you must go up. Did you get that? That if you desire to grow, the only time we really grow is when we're uncomfortable. Very few people grow. I remember when I played in Cleveland. And so at the end of the season, you know what I would do? I would stop lifting weights. I would always stop lifting weights because what I wanted my body to do is I wanted my body to rest. And so I would spend 6 weeks just allowing my body to rest. I wouldn't lift any weights. So when I reported back to Cleveland, my body was really soft. And so I had about 4 months to now redevelop my body and get it back into shape. And so you know what I would do? I would go in there and I would start pumping iron. Now, I didn't lift light weights. You know why? Because the muscles would not get the resistance that I needed for my muscles to get bigger and stronger. And so I would have to get there, and I'd have to get up, and I'd have to put 350, 400, 500 pounds on a bench, and I'd have to pump it 3 or 4 times. But the more weight that I put on, the more resistance. But what the resistance did, it caused me to grow. And that's your spiritual life. That as we go out into this world, you can't go out into this world continuing to be casual. If you want to see if God provides, let me just give you, I want to give you one idea. Try to give more. Better use flexing some muscles now. But say, God, you know what? I'm just going to bless you like never before. Try to give. Pastor, I want to tell you now, give them every chance you can just to give. Give them, just pray you ask the Lord. Give them chances because, listen, the more you go, the more you grow, the more chances you take, and the more sacrifices that you make, you grow spiritually. And God has called us to grow. And the only way we're going to grow is to say, how do we go out into this world and make an impact? Listen, I understand that many of you are from this area, and I have taken the time to drive all throughout this area to understand this area. That's why I had a great conversation about hunting today. I learned all about the area. I know more about your area than you can imagine. I know about how spread out it is. I went into a school zone, and Lord knows, I mean, it was unbelievable how slow they drive, and that's okay. But I just learned, I looked at the mountainsides, I looked at everything. I said, God, you know what? It could be hard to go. Where do you go? How do you really look? Well, I'm going to tell you if you really want to grow and if you want to go, let me tell you what you do. Why don't you go to the school system and say, what are the problems are you having here? And then when they tell it, sit down and say, well, which one am I going to fix? That's how you grow. You don't just go and say, oh, I heard this ministry is doing this and that ministry is doing that. That's not how you grow. You go into the community and you start all of a sudden asking questions. What is going on inside of here and how in the world can we serve? And so all of a sudden, if you've got issues with adopting young babies in this community, your question is, how do we fix that? How do we raise these young men and these young women up so they could be godly young men and women? It may even take that I might have to move somebody into my house, but God, I'm going to have to do something as opposed to just sit back here in my comfort zone and be comfortable. Amen. You just go and just find the problem. I love that about my pastor. He would always say that when I went to Washington, D.C. And I said, Pastor, I said, man, listen, I'm going to D.C., and we don't have but 6 members in our church. We only had 6 members. They were all white, over 70 years old. Now, don't you think that was a pretty good start as a church? Amen. But you know what Pastor says, Rick? find the problem. So 30 days later, after I got there, he called me and he says, hey, did you find any problems? I said, yeah. I said, young people are killing each other. He said, really? He said, so what are you going to do about it? So I went to the school and started volunteering. I did. I'm the pastor of the church with six people. I didn't have anything else to do. You know what I mean? And so six people, you know. And that's all they wanted to do. They wanted a 30-minute worship service with two hymns. And I'm like, oh, Lord, that's bad, right? And he said, Ricky, I want you to do something as if God's going to take care of you. He said, go take a risk. I went to the school and started volunteering. And all of the people started, you know, the principal said, man, we appreciate you coming here. Then I started bringing some of my friends who had retired from the NFL. I call them up, everyone that lived in D.C., I was calling my buddies, hey, I go up here. And you know what I was doing? I was doing cafeteria duty. That's what I did. I go stand in the cafeteria, and these little kids were tough, you know. And I stand up there, and I'd still pump a little iron, and I was kind of flexing my muscles and, you know, just showing like a little you in the back. I was showing it to them. It's like, don't you come fool with me now. I don't play. And then I started bringing my friends back with me. And so it was about four of us standing up in the school. And I said, man, listen, I got my four buddies, and I said, Kevin, I've been dreaming. What if we started a youth center? And you know what? We just said, okay. And you know what we did? There was a burned out building, and there were two apartment buildings right beside it, so three apartment buildings in a row. One block from the school, right across the street from the junior high school. And I said, man, why don't we start praying and asking the Lord? And we started praying, and all of a sudden the guy called and he said, man, what in the world can we all dream about? He had a suburban church with about 20,000 members. And I said, really? I like it. So I went and met with him, and he asked me to preach, and I was preaching. And I'm not kidding you, this is the truth. I preached the first sermon that I ever preached at that church. And who was sitting on the front row? A guy by the name of Ken Starr. Now, Ken Starr investigated the president back in the 90s. And when I got through preaching, Ken Starr said, hey, can you meet with me for lunch? And I said, yeah, I'll meet with you. And he had five other men sitting around a table. And I said, yeah, Ken. He said, what are you doing down in the city? And I told him about me volunteering, and I told him about these buildings. And so he invited his five friends over to the table. And I said, I had no clue who they were. He says, Ricky's getting ready. That's what he tells his five friends. Ricky's getting ready to buy five buildings, and he's already got his eye on the first building. And I'm saying, huh, okay, that's cool. Ken said, who's going to pay for the first building? So the guy said, how much is it going to cost? I said, $90,000. This was in the early 90s. And the guy said, I'll take care of it. I said, really? God will provide. When you start building God's kingdom and trusting God, God will provide. I had no idea where it would come from. But the problem is, we've got to say, God, how do we begin to go where there are problems? Because God loves people too much. And when you start praying for people and allowing God to widen your territory and broadening your territory, God will say, listen, I don't care what is needed, I will provide it for you. I care about people. Listen, you think God cared about that building? No, that building was a tool. God cared so much more about the 140 kids that would come over every day, and now they're deacons in their church and they've been discipled well. That's what God cares about. But if you want to grow, don't just sit at home looking in the news. Go out and find out where there are problems and know that God desires to be there. And whatever the problem is, God will fix it. Let me hurry up. I'm sorry. I kind of went off on that one. But listen, I got another one I wanted to tell you. I put this one on number two. My God, this one is a good one here. Transition beyond our comfort zone means we must live in the tensions of being amazed or afraid. Ah, that's good. Did you hear that? No, 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 no. Did you see the tension that these guys were in? No, no, I'll show it to you. Listen. Now I'm going to mess up the people on the overheads, but I'm going to have to jump around. Listen to Acts chapter 8, verse 1. It said, Saul was one of the witnesses, and he agreed completely with the killing of Stephen. A great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem. And all the believers except the apostles were scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria. They were afraid. You got a crackpot like Saul or Paul who comes in and stone a man just because he's standing up for his faith. And not only that, but he's looking for more people to kill. What emotions did he have? He was afraid. Guess why they scattered? They were all afraid. What's going to happen to us? And God's been trying to get them to leave Jerusalem for 8 chapters. Ah, they just hit the road. They're afraid. But watch this. Oh, I got to read this one to you. Listen, please be patient. You got to hear this one. This is going to bless your heart. But listen to what it says here, though. It says here in Acts 8:5-8. Listen to what it says here. So you've got them being afraid, but just go down 3 verses and listen to what it says. When Philip, it says, Philip went down to a city in, well, Samaria. Up! That's where Philip went. That's where Jesus told him to go. He went down to a city in Samaria, listen, and proclaimed the Messiah there. Talking about Jesus. When the crowds heard Philip and saw the signs he performed, they all paid close attention to what he said. For with shrieks, impure spirits came out of many, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. Now listen, verse 8. So there was great joy in that city. Woo! In verse 1, they're afraid. Ah! Because they're what? Listen, Jesus is pushing them out. In verse 5-8, hey, great joy is in the city. You can always tell when you're living outside of your comfort zone because you're not in the middle of being comfortable. You're either amazed or afraid. Because, listen, when you're amazed or afraid, you're not depending upon no one but God. When you're in your comfort zone, you're only dependent upon yourself. Oh, God, I can't do this. That task is too big. Oh, God, look at little old me. Oh, I'm just so depressed. The world is coming to the end. The world is dying. And, oh, God, how can we go save this world? Where are you at? Jesus is saying, if you're really following me, you're going to either be in verse 1, or you're going to be in verse 5-8. There is no middle ground. Ah, isn't that good? Isn't that good? And then I got one more I got to give you. And so I'm going to do this and I'm going to let you go. Is that all right? Oh, come on. You can say it louder than that, can't you? And so I had to leave this one with you. Because I don't want you to think that getting out of your comfort zone simply means miracles. It does mean miracles. I got to tell you, I hope you believe in miracles. Because I grew up in a very conservative environment where they didn't believe in miracles. They didn't teach me how to believe in miracles. I never trusted the Holy Spirit to do anything. And so I would walk around and so God told me one day they didn't do miracles no more in the church. The gift of healing didn't exist anymore. And I will never forget, one day, I'd been thinking about healing for a long time. And I will never forget, my mother-in-law went into a coma. And she's about 90 now, but she went into a coma and she'd been in there for about 3 weeks. And so my mother-in-law is in this coma and I'm sitting there and so my wife is crying. Oh, so we get on a plane, go to Dallas, and then we go up to the hospital the first night and her sisters and they were all, they're all crying. And I'm like, oh Lord, I got to get out of here. And so I just slipped out and I went back to my mother-in-law's house. That's where we were staying. And so I'd been there and I went to saw my family and hung out for a few days. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit prompted me. I'm telling you, listen, I am not one of those Benny Hinn guys. I am just a guy who just said every day, Jesus, how do I love you and serve you? But the Lord prompted my spirit. He said, you go up there and lay hands on her. Hallelujah. And I just said, what? Lord, seminary didn't teach me that. And they didn't even teach me I should believe in that. And the Lord said, I know they didn't teach you, but I want you to go. And so I lived about 3 miles from the hospital. I needed time to process what was happening. So I walked. I didn't drive. I walked to the hospital 3 miles. Just walked up. So when I got there, I called my wife, said, hey, come down and buzz me in so I can go in and be, you know, just be with mom. And so Glenda came down and she got me in. And I said, the Lord told me to come up here. And she said, you know, you don't normally talk like this. What's going on inside of you? And I said, the Lord told me to do something. I got to do it. And she said, what do you mean the Lord called you to do something? I said, come on. So I walked up to the bedroom. I got to tell you this, sir. You got to hear this. And I walked up to the bedroom. And I stood at the end, and the mother was just laying down there, just, you know, she'd been in a coma for several weeks. And she was just laying there. So I said to her two sisters, Scootie and Jenny, I said, could y'all leave the room? Glenda, you can stay, but y'all leave the room for a second. And they're like, well, what do you want us to leave for? I said, just leave the room. You know, Spirit was kind of provoking me to get them out of there because I didn't need an audience, you know what I mean? And so I just said, y'all just leave the room. So my wife is sitting here. And so when they leave the room, I go and make sure the door is closed. I walk back up. And I sit at the foot of her bed. And I had never done anything like this before. And I just looked and I just said, Lord, if, you know, I'm not grandstanding, but Lord, I know you told me to do it, so I'm going to just give it a shot. And I just said, get up! And I said that. Just. Her mother rose up. Listen, didn't have her teeth in her mouth, and she started smiling. So she distracted me a little bit because, you know, I was like, ah! And my wife screamed, ah! My wife screamed, nothing like that. I had never done that before. And I just said, Glenda, I've got to go. I don't know how to handle this. And so I walked out. I just walked down the stairs and walked out, and I walked back home. But I cried all the way home, and I said, God, what did you just do? I don't understand it. You just told me to pray and lay hands on her, and that's all. I just said, get up, and she got up. She's been down. And so what I want to encourage you, don't just write off God. God can do whatever he wants to do. And especially when you're living in between these tensions of being amazed and afraid, it is you're trusting and seeking God. And you're asking God to do it. And God, I don't know. It's your choice. I don't get to choose. It's your choice who you rise up. And you know what? Four other people since that day I've laid hands on. And they've been healed. And I know I didn't do it. It was the Lord. And so I just want to encourage you. You know, when we talk about the Holy Spirit, that's not a gimmick or a game. Amen. See, when you seek the Lord, see, the Holy Spirit is God. He, a person. It is he, the Father, he, the Son, he, the Holy Spirit. He is a person, and he can do whatever he wants to do. If the Father can do it, and if the Son can do it, then certainly God, the Holy Spirit, oh, my God, let me leave that alone. Listen, I got to get through. That was not my third point, so you got to just wait here. Let me tell you what it is. It says, the shift from comfort to chaos means we must be willing to love people unconditionally. Now, if you came here last night, you heard this, but I got to give you something else because I was praying about this, and the Lord said, you got to tell them. See, why? They've got to love people unconditionally. If I ask you if you loved unconditionally, just with a show of hand, tell me if you think that you're the type of person who can love people unconditionally. Just raise your hand up. Oh, Lord, we're in trouble, aren't we? No, I want to see them real good. Okay, if you love people, okay. Okay, so let me tell you. See, loving people unconditionally, our purpose is to love people. That's why God made us. You remember when the rich young brother walked up to Jesus and he said, out of all the Bible verses that we have in the Old Testament, he says, which one is the greatest? And Jesus said to him, he said, the greatest commandment is to love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love your neighbor as you love yourself. That's our purpose. No matter what we do in life, that's why forgiveness. There are people who can't forgive. And that's what I'm saying. And that reason why I ask you to raise your hand is there are people who are still holding grudges. Well, you don't have the capacity to love. That's all it is. You're still holding grudges, and God's called us to love everybody. And then you remember over in 1 Corinthians 13, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels and I don't have love, I'm just a bunch of noise or a clinging symbol. That's what that means. And when it said faith, hope, and love, the greatest is love. Yeah, and then over in John it says that God is love. That's who God is. And so the greatest privilege we can do is go out and love people. Every morning you wake up, you should be on a mission field. And you should say, God, who in the world are you going to put in my life to love today? Every day you leave your house, you should be on a mission field saying, God, I know you're going to have somebody to come into my place. Listen, Marty, when you go to your barbershop, you have so many people coming through, you should be praying, God, I know there's going to be somebody coming through this place. And I know somebody's going to be hurting, God, and you're going to use me in a special and a mighty way to love them like they've never been loved before. That is our purpose. And so I had to come up with something. I was struggling in my marriage one day. I was struggling with my wife. And all of a sudden, this is what the Holy Spirit said to me. You got to hear this now. The Holy Spirit said, unconditional love can never be unconditional love until there is a condition. Up! Listen, you missed that, didn't you? I'm going to say it again. Unconditional love can never be unconditional love until there's a condition. See, most of us go down a wedding aisle and say, hey, I'm going to love you unconditionally. And that's why there's a 53% divorce rate in this country today. Amen. Because we don't understand unconditional love. You can only determine whether or not you love someone unconditionally until there's a condition. Let me give you an example. If my wife comes home and said, baby, I've had an affair, and I've been having an affair for 8 months. Oh, now there's a condition. Unconditional love is never unconditional love until there's a condition. The affair becomes the condition. And so I have to say, now God, am I going to love her the way you loved us? Because God loves us unconditionally. No matter what sin we commit, God loves us anyway. No matter how bad we are, God loves us anyway. There's nothing, that's what Paul says, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Isn't that what Paul says? There's nothing. And so all of a sudden we get this condition. And you know when we get the condition, guess what most people do? They walk away and leave. See, unconditional love can only be unconditional love when there's a condition. And what unconditional love says, you know what? We got to figure this out. We got to pull this back together. That no matter how bad it feels emotionally, my love is deeper than that for you. Oh, what about, you know, your child go to college and she comes back and she said, hey, I'm in the LGBTQ now. And I like another, she's a female, she said, I like another woman. Oh, he's a male, he said, I like another man. Oh, now you've got the condition. That's right. Now you got a condition. Now you get to determine, do I really love him? Do you know what most parents would do? They turn around and walk away. Not unconditional love. Unconditional love says, you know, I may not agree with what you're doing, but I love you very much. Amen. I don't have to agree with what you're doing, but I'm not going to stop loving you. And that's what Jesus was doing. That's what Luke was trying to tell these apostles. God, there are so many people that are broken in this world. And Luke was saying, you've got to go out and love the world. You've got to love the world unconditionally. You've got to, listen, if you're here tonight and you are holding grudges with people, the greatest gift you can give them is to go home and pick up the phone and say, you know what? I want to throw in the towel and call the truth. We're not going to do that anymore. Because I've been called to love you. It could be your parents, it could be your child, it could be your neighbor, whomever the person is. God has called you to love them unconditionally. Ah. Can you imagine when a church starts doing that? You'll rock this entire community. To say, I don't know what your condition is. Whatever the condition is, I'm going to move beyond the condition. And I'm going to love you anyway. That's what Luke was trying. He's trying to tell the people, when you take that kind of love into this world, you're going to turn the world upside down. Now, can you do it? That's the question. Listen, I know I need to let you go. I haven't had you up here. I'm so glad they didn't start the clock. The clock's been stuck ever since I've been going, so I didn't have a timer. He said, they didn't even turn it on. Isn't that good? Amen. Bless them. Bless them. They probably forgot, but that's okay. The Lord remembered that. Listen to me. So remember I said, I didn't come for motivation or inspiration. I came for identification. I came for those who said, Rick, it's time for me to go further. It's time for me to take my spiritual life to the next level. It is time for me, Ricky, I don't care maybe it's me starting in a small group, maybe it's me serving, maybe it's me, I don't know what it is, but it is time for me to go to the next, maybe it starts with a meeting with me and my pastor just saying, you know, what is it, what can I do to go to the next level? Maybe it's you saying, God, I need to start a devotional life. I'm not studying your word, and I need to build up a habit of studying your word, so therefore I'm going to wake up early in the morning and get in your word like I've never gotten in your word before. Or maybe it's you starting your prayer life saying, God, I want to be closer to you. God, I want to have an intimacy, and I'm not just going to pray one time in the morning and wing it all day. I'm going to pray, and every time I think about you, God, I'm going to talk to you like I've never talked to you before. God, I need to make some changes, Lord, in my life. See, that's identification. God, I want to go to the next level. Would you all come on up and sing? But listen. So tonight is not for you to be saved. I've been working on that for 3 nights. Amen. Yeah. Tonight for you to say, hey, it's time for me to go to the next level. It's time for me to transition from comfort to chaos. It is time for me to say, God, it is time for me to get serious about this. I want my family to see that I'm serious. I'm not going to live in this comfortable space. If I want my marriage to work, guess what? I can't be in a comfortable space. I've got to move into chaos where that I'm loving people unconditionally. If you're here, this is my last night. I want to pray for you. If you say, Rick, it is time, I need to go to the next level. The altar is open. Just come up here, and when they finish this song, I want to come and pray for you. But right now, anytime during this song, I want you to stand up and come up here so I can pray for you. Is that all right? I'm going to the next level. I'm going to make a commitment. I know I'm not doing what I need to be doing now, but I am going to the next level in my life. That's transitioning from comfort to chaos. I'm going to live in chaos. I'm going to live in chaos, Lord, where I'm either amazed or afraid. Would you minister to us, and then I'll come back and pray for us. Just come in anytime. Just stand up. I'm going to pray for you.
You.
I set my eyes on perfect faith. You'll finish what you start in me. My heart will be an offering. I'll trade all my fear for peace of mind. All my heaviness for burdens light. And this will be my song. You are always good. I'll sing it all day long. You are always good. And when the day is through, I am left with you.
Time to go to the next level. And you know, you may not have come today. Maybe right where you are, you say, Rick, it's time for me to go. Just stand up right where you are. I want to pray for you right where you are. Just even out in the audience. Just if you say, Rick, it is time for me to go, just stand up right where you are. Would you do that for me? I want this to be my night that I can know that I will be praying for you tonight and I will continue. Just stand up wherever you are. Just say, Ricky, I want to be prayed for tonight. I want you to include me. Because I'm going to the next level. I'm no longer going to be in comfort. You see, it's comfortable to sleep in late, isn't it? That's the most comfortable thing you can do. It's chaos to wake up and say, God, I'm going to start reading the Word. It's comfortable to not pray and have a prayer life with the Lord. It's chaos to say, God, I'm going to pray all day long. That if I go to the store, I'm going to ask you to tell me someone that I can speak to, that when I go to the cleaners, you'll tell me someone to speak to. When I go to Walmart, God, I'm going to ask you just to be with me so that I can connect with the right person. See, that's chaos there, isn't it? Because now God's driving the truck. Father, I thank you so much for my brothers and sisters. And Jesus, right now, I ask you to blow a fresh wind of your Holy Spirit into their hearts right now, Jesus. Father, blow a fresh wind that is so strong that, Father, it will motivate them even as they leave tonight, that they will assess and evaluate where they are with you, Jesus. And that, Father, they can begin to self-reflect and look at their lives. But more importantly, Father, they will desire change. And that change comes from you, Jesus. Father, some of them, Father, just might. They just might need to consult someone to help them on their journey. Whether it be a pastor or an elder, Father, I pray that you will empower them to consult the right person so that will help empower them to go to the next level. Therefore, Father, I submit and commit this body to you. Everyone under the sound of my voice, I submit and commit to you like never before, Jesus. And I thank you for them as they go out into this world and make an impact. To you be glory, honor, and praise in your name, Jesus. Amen. Greet three or four people around you and tell them, let's do this thing. Will you do that? Just greet three or four people around you and tell them, let's do this thing. Thank you, Pastor.